They say your wedding is one of the most important times in your life, that it's something you will remember for as long as you live, and it's the day where you become legally entitled to half of his or her land. With that in mind, and given that I've been planning my wedding over the past few months, I'm going to dispense some wisdom.
Oh, this will be good.
Really, we should be getting my other half on the podcast to dispense some wisdom, because I have been taking a back seat as I've been very busy travelling around the world. But...
Right, John, you're getting married. Where are you starting?
Supposed to propose.
Okay, lay it on us. Was it romantic? Were the stars shining?
I think you played a bigger part in the proposal than Annie did. So the proposal happened. We were doing a gig in Abu Dhabi, and
we were.
I got the notion that it was time, and that I got a wobbly knee, and it was time to just batten down the hatches. Age wasn't on my side. I wasn't looking my best. I was like, look, let's just fucking pull the trigger now. Lock her in. She can't leave if we get married. So
that is romance.
So I rang her sister one night, the night before we left Abu Dhabi. And we might have been drinking all day at the pool and might have been fairly well on when I rang her sister. And I said, I'm thinking of proposing. And she said, are you drunk? And I said, I had a few. And she said, are you serious? I said, deadly serious. And then she was like, I don't know. And I was like, you're not feeling me with confidence. She was like, okay. So I asked her ring size, and she gave me her ring size. So Annie's sister gave me her ring size.
Okay.
Not Annie's one, but she was like, I'd say she's in around the same size. So the next morning, myself and John woke up, and I was like, look, I have to go to the jeweler's. And he was like, for what? And I was like, get an engagement ring, lad. And he was like, oh, lad. That was honestly his reaction. Was like, oh, lad. And we bet off to the jeweler's. The sweat was fucking beading out of us. The two of us were like severely hungover. It's around 45 degrees. So we got the ring anyway, right? But me and Johnny by ourselves sat down, and some fella came over, a freaky looking fella. Do you want a scene in Love Actually where he's like, do you want the gifts wrapped? Yeah. That kind of a dude. And we picked out the ring, me and Johnny, didn't we?
Yeah, I never told Annie I had a hand in picking her ring.
But we picked it out anyway, and lovely, paid the money, extortionate price. But I must say, if to any lads out there, here's my first tip. Yeah. You're buying a ring.
Yeah.
Buy it in a place where you don't have to pay tax on the ring.
Okay, yeah.
So you're getting it for a reduced price. Annie, that doesn't mean I love you any less. But tax, who wants to be paying it if you can avoid it? So we got the ring. Get to the airport. We're still hungover. We get on the plane. And this is where the famous story of me passing out on the plane happens. So for anybody who doesn't know that from an earlier podcast, I passed out on this plane from Abu Dhabi to Dublin because I felt very weak. And I asked the air hostess for water, and they couldn't because we're taking off. So I passed out. They ended up dragging me down the back of the plane.
By your ankles.
By my ankles. Honestly, it was fair embarrassing. And down the back of the plane, they put an oxygen mask on me. I'm lying down the back of the plane. I can barely breathe. Johnny standing over me going, oh, lad, you all right? You all right, lad? And all the while I was passed out, I still managed to keep my hand in my pocket, because in my pocket was the ring.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, I'm not dying and losing the money for the ring. So kept the ring anyway. And I still felt sick. And if you remember, Mara, when we landed back in Dublin, we went straight to RTE and we recorded this podcast.
Yeah.
And I was still peaky. I was still white. So I'd planned this real romantic proposal. But by the time I'd actually reached home to care, I was fucked. I was absolutely exhausted. So I bundled in the door, and Annie was coming out. She was after getting an Indian from the local takeaway. And she came out with all the plates in her hands. And I was like, one second. And I dropped my suitcase.
Yeah.
And then I ran up to her parents' house. I text her brother and was like, is your dad here?
Yeah.
And her brother just texts back the ring emoji. And I was like, oh, jeez. So her dad is a typical Irish man. Do you know what I mean? He's sitting in there. So he went into the spare room, right? And I was like, oh, fuck. This is making it even awkward now. So I went in, and he was sitting on the corner of the bed. It was like something out of Godfather. I was like, I was shaking like a leaf. And I was like, I got a ring in Abu Dhabi. And he was like, what? And I was like, oh. It's like, I got a ring in Abu Dhabi. He was like, what? For what? And I was like, look.
For what?
Yeah, for what? And I was like, look, if it's all right with you, I'm going to ask Annie. And he was like, oh, yeah. Good man. Oh, just good man, yeah. When are you doing it? And I was like, I'll probably do it now. I'll call down so in 10 minutes and we'll go into the pub. It was exactly what he responded with.
And you were absolutely dying coming off the plane.
So I'm still dying at this year. I'm still sweating. So I got down, and I was planning on doing it around a week later. Yeah. Something real romantic. But to be honest, after the near-death experience I had, so I still went down. And he was just about to chomp into a poppadom. And I just dropped them on knee and was like, look, this isn't the way I want to do it, but will you? And then she was like, yeah, and a bit crying. And I swear to God, I no sooner had her hugged, like, I'd given her a hug, like, and her father burst in with her brother and was like, come on, we'll go into the Joker. So our local GA draw was on.
The lotto. Yeah.
The lotto. So I had no chance to even celebrate or anything. I didn't even get to eat me Indian.
Oh.
I went into the Joker. Now, bear in mind, the sweat's still beating on me. And everyone starts buying whiskey for me. The room was spinning and everything. I didn't know where I was. It was one of the worst experiences of my life. But that was the proposal. It wasn't pretty, but we got the job done. And just...
Does it matter?
Oh, she would have loved the one with bells and whistles and all that, I'm sure, like any woman, but like...
Yeah.
I'm a fuck-up, so yeah, I think
you just, you know, you're setting the tone for how marriage is going to be.
Yeah.
So yeah. You'd love bells and whistles, but, you know, an Indian takeaway would be...
I know. Some lads organise it, that they do the proposal in like a really scenic location and get a special, like pay a photographer actually come to take photos of the moment. Wow. And stuff like that.
Wow.
But I know...
Some lads, you mean some women do?
Yeah. Yeah. Some women tell the lads, like, here is how I'd like to be proposed to you. I.e. here's a... But I do know, I better be very unspecific, but I know, let's say... One guy where he got the fiance's sister to take the photos, and like they just look weird. It's like somebody's like lurking in a bush taking.
Yeah, so the proposal didn't go that well. It's probably a sign of things to come.
Yeah, I don't think it's that important. As long as it's sincere.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. But I do think it's... Annie's so sound, I'd say she wouldn't have cared at all, and she puts up with you, so yeah.
thanks Maura.
Yeah, I'd say other women are a bit more like, nah, I need to have my proposal bigger and better than that bitch down the road. So yeah. Some people get competitive about
it. I was eating the korma that night at 3:30 when I got home from the pub. Still nearly dead. But then, right, what happens then is the proposal's done, the whole lot, and then you have to start thinking of the actual wedding. So some people get engaged to stay engaged for like 10 years. That's not what I want. I want to just get out of the way. Get the paper done.
So your first decision you said to us was church or civil ceremony?
Yeah, or abroad.
Or abroad.
Yeah, were the three options. But like...
You're going with the church?
Yeah, we're going with the church.
Why is that?
Our family are holy enough.
Yeah. And what are you?
I like the idea of a church. I just like the music and stuff in a church. Like any wedding I've been to actually has been in a church. So I've never actually experienced... a different kind of wedding.
I was at a humanist ceremony and they had it in summer outdoors.
Okay.
It was nice, right?
Yeah.
The ring bearers, two dogs.
Oh, class.
It's hard enough to get a flower girl to walk up the aisle. Imagine trying to get a dog shitting everywhere.
You might have a little like piece of a rasher in your pocket at the altar. Come. Yeah, no.
Yeah.
The ring boy shitting on someone.
I YouTubed the bit, like, I YouTubed, like, you know, kind of the hotel weddings and stuff like that. They look grand, like, and it just wasn't for us. And plus, the amount of people that we have going to the wedding, a church just makes more sense to actually fit them.
Right.
She comes from a big family. So that was decided fairly easy. We weren't going to bring everyone abroad because I think that puts a lot of stress on people.
Money.
If you're going to have a nice little small wedding, then you could go abroad. But if you're saying to a lot of people, look, come abroad.
Yeah, I think abroad weddings are a way of, you know, avoiding the relatives that you hate.
Yeah. So
we're only having a small one, so none of you are invited.
So the church wedding was decided. Then next was picking the reception venue.
Yeah.
Which is tough because, like, all I want to do at this wedding is have the crack. Like, I'm treating this like it's a Two Johnnies show. Going big, you know, fireworks, all that.
Getting the posters done.
Yeah, I just want to crack, like. So picking the venue can be tough because we went to one place in Cork, I won't name it. And, like, I was dressed normally, had skinny jeans on, had the ankles out. And it was summertime, so I had a t-shirt on. This place wasn't very posh. And I walked in and your man kind of took a look at us. Because we were young, like, and probably thought, like, we don't have any money. He'd have been right. But, and he was just, I found he was very ignorant. And then I was like, look.
In what way? Sorry.
So I feel like, first of all, he had judged us because we were young.
Yeah.
Right. And then secondly, I was like, look, this will be a young enough wedding. A lot of people going to be young. Like, what time do you close at? 3:00, no exceptions. He was like, everything closes 3:00. And I was like, right, okay, this probably isn't the place for us.
Yeah.
And also the ballroom had a load of pillars.
Okay.
Which wrecks my head. I don't like when ballrooms have pillars. because
obstruct the view of speeches and stuff.
Yeah, okay. And like I just think it looks odd, so I don't like it.
I think knowing you, it's more like if somebody is kind of curt, and yeah, short with you like that, it's like, yeah, not dealing with that shit.
And I am big on like first impressions. Mm. Yeah. So it's very hard for me to change my mind, which is probably a bad trait.
Spending a lot of money, like you're gonna want to like the person.
That's what I was saying. Like I was like, I'm spending like a lot of money. Like
stop being a prick.
Yeah. So and then we went into another place in Cork. We went to Castle Martyr, and Castle Martyr is very posh. Mm. And we got the price list, whatever. And like it's grand. Like, it wasn't like absolutely extortionate. Like it was tasty. Like, but it wasn't that bad. But the one thing I got in Castle Martyr was lovely place, and it's very classic and quaint. But I think we're kind of modern, so I wasn't into that real like, you know, oh, that's a lovely arch on the doorway. And plus, I took one looking around and said, the people coming to this wedding will wreck this place. And I'm not footing the bill. So Castle Martyr was off the table, and eventually we found a place. And the reason we went, so I liked this place from the beginning because me and Johnny done a gig there one time. Mm. So I knew the room, I knew it was nice, and I knew the staff were good. So we went in, and they obviously took one look at me and said, this lad likes his food. So when we went in, they were like, sit down, and gave us a complimentary scone.
Yeah.
Right? I don't like scones. I don't like jam, and I never had a scone with jam and cream. But for some reason, out of courtesy, I ate this scone. Took one bite out of it. I looked at Annie and said, I reckon this is the place. It was the nicest thing I'd ever ate. And plus, the girl who kind of organises our wedding for the hotel. Mm. So, I don't know, she's like a liaison wedding officer.
What? Tell people, what was the first question you asked her?
So, no, but she was sound to us first, right? And the first thing she said to us was like, if you have any questions now, don't be afraid to ask, which neither of the previous people had said to us.
Yeah.
So I was like, I have a couple of questions. And I see Annie just going, oh, for fuck's sake. And I was like, when do you pour the first glass of wine? How often do you serve it? What time do you stop serving in the hall at? And what time do you close the residence bar? And she said, we serve the first glass of wine whenever you want. We'll serve the wine as many times as you want. She said, we'll serve until 3 o'clock in the main hall, or, you know, she said, we could go to 4, and if you're well behaved, we won't close the residence bar at all. I said, you have a deal. Because honestly, any wedding I'm at, that's all I want, is just good beer, good music, and I don't want any hassle. Mm. So let us go all night as long as we're behaving ourselves. So when she said that, music to my ears, Annie could see I was foaming up. Give me the form, I want to get signed, I want to get home.
Do you remember we went to one wedding in Cork and they wouldn't serve Jaeger bombs?
Yeah, yeah. It was Lucasade and vodka. Yeah, they wouldn't serve Red Bull.
Another place then wouldn't allow the Huckle Buck. No, they wouldn't allow Rock the Boat.
Rock the Boat, yeah.
Is that for insurance reasons?
Probably. I don't give a damn.
I haven't asked, but I'm going to get to put in my contract for the wedding now. Rock the Boat is allowed. But yeah, that was one of the things. But like, you know what a crack of weddings like, because you've been in a wedding, man. You know much more than that. The crack is the most important thing.
Yeah, on a hall, on the venue, you've got to pick a room you're going to fill. Mm. Yeah. We'd go into a wedding and like there might be 80 people in a room that could hold 300. Oh, God. Straight away, it's a crack vacuum.
Yeah.
And you just have notions about it's going to be this or that. Pick a room you're going to fill. That's my top piece of advice.
Yeah.
On a venue. The pre-marriage, Johnny.
So when you decide you're going to get married in a church, I didn't know that like you have to do a pre-marriage course. I knew there was such a thing, but I thought that was done away with now. But if you're getting married in a church, you have to do a pre-marriage course. Spoke about it before on the podcast. Two nice people, middle-aged people, telling you how to live your life. I found it very strange. I found it quite odd. But we had to fill in around 10 forms to do the pre-marriage course. And I thought, that's all right. Done with forms now.
What kind of things were they asking you on the form?
Your name and date of birth. few things like that. But then like, Just general kind of paperwork and where you were having the wedding and like who's your priest. And I was like, I don't know. We hadn't decided that yet. Yeah. So there's bits that you haven't decided. So I thought, that's all the forms filled out. That was stressful. It's over. Wrong. You have another meeting now. So you have to go to your local, is it municipal or what? I don't know. Some office. So
municipal.
We'd go to Clonmel. Now, me and Annie are fairly laid back about this whole wedding thing. So 4 times we'd reschedule the meeting because 2 Johnny stuff kept coming up. So we'd have a meeting or we'd have to go to Dublin or such and such. So Annie was growing tired of this, so she cancelled the meeting a couple of times and she had to keep ringing around the office and be like, I'm going to have to cancel. And then, so she cancelled anyway and got the meeting for Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock and we both forgot about the meeting. So we're lying in bed and it's like 10 past 10 and Annie's like, fuck, that meeting in Clonmel's at 10 o'clock. And I was like, oh, Jesus. And I was away the rest of the week with Johnny. And she was like, I'll ring your one and just tell her like that we had an emergency. And she rang your one. And Annie was like, look, can we come in at 10:30?
Yeah.
So we literally washed our faces, threw on the clothes and bet into the office. And we were stink going in there like. And your one was being prickly. Obviously, we called off the meeting 4 times.
Yeah.
And obviously, we were late for this meeting again. And your one was being fairly curt on the phone to Annie. And Annie went up to the... I obviously sent Annie up to the hatch. I'm not dealing with any conflict. And she was going up and Annie came back and was like, your one's a bit sharp. She's a bit dodgy, this one. I don't think she likes us. And then when we went into the actual office to have the meeting with her, she was like, oh, you're your man from Two Johnnies. I was like, yeah. And then she changed her tune then fairly quick. But again, fill in loads of forms.
Mm.
And like, so after that meeting, you're pretty much technically married. You just have to sign the actual forms. So
okay.
This is the actual form that you sign on the day of your wedding in the church, which I didn't know.
Right.
I had no idea. I thought you just went and your man was like, you're married. No, thanks a million. So out the door.
Yeah.
But you have to fill in this form and stuff like that. So again,
Who's going to bring that form to the church to sign?
The best man.
Fuck's sake. When I threw that now. I didn't know. I thought I just organised the stag.
That happened at a friend of mine's wedding. They had the church ceremony and then they're like, okay, we'll have to sign the documents out. And he's like, I've left them at home. So they had to, they signed them in a room at the reception venue.
Oh
so.
My God. Because a friend of mine was actually just saying that if you don't bring that form back within 10 days and your one said the same in the office, you're not legally married. So my friend texted me and was like, who is divorced? He texted me and was like, listen, do yourself a favour there. Don't bring them forms back just in case. I was like, sound. Thanks for the optimism. Look, we're running out of time on this topic.
Mm-hmm.
I think we've got loads more to say.
We're only starting.
We're only touching the base. So look, we'll knock back in a couple of weeks. Maybe we'll do the wedding part two.
The wedding part two, lads. Yes. Tune in.